But what was the name of this song? I know the Gaithers, but I don't know that I knew that
Holy,
song.
I bowed on my knees and I cried holy. Is that the name of it?
Oh, I don't remember.
Yes, but that's definitely a theme in Revelation. I haven't really mentioned that much, but worship. There's a lot of worship that goes on, and a lot of music is inspired by the things that are written in Revelation. So whenever they're in heaven, whenever those four beasts show up, they kind of have a party. They have worship time. So there's a lot of that going on. But anyway, I'm glad you guys came back. You didn't run away. That's great. Thank you. So we'll just get started. If I can get the PowerPoint going, sometimes I'm never entirely sure what's going to work and what isn't with technology. But I thought I'd also bring in an example of Revelation in popular culture, because it shows up all the time. So any of you guys read this comic strip? This is another thing that my dad likes, so tonight I'm going to devote to my father. So here we go. I'll read it to you just in case you can't see it. Genesis, nothing. Exodus, nothing. Leviticus, nothing. Ezekiel, nothing. Daniel, nothing. Revelation, nothing. I don't get it. Putting NSYNC in the next Star Wars has to be a biblical sign of the apocalypse. Here, try King James Version. So it's a little dated now. This was from a few years back. But as you can tell, the apocalypse didn't happen. NSYNC being in Star Wars was not a sign of the apocalypse. But it's interesting that even people who maybe they didn't grow up in the church, maybe they did, but Revelation has filtered into popular culture so much that pretty much everybody knows 666 is a sign of the beast, right? So there are some things that just are prevalent throughout culture. And just on a side note, too, since last week we were talking about Smyrna, modern Izmir, I thought I would bring in this picture, maybe a little grainy, but one of my good friends and colleagues is over in Turkey this week on a trip where they're seeing the seven cities of Revelation with the company that I work with. And she texted me this picture today, I think just to rub it in, of how nice and beautiful it is. She's like, look at the view from my hotel and how warm and sunny it is. I'm like, yeah, it's gray and cold in Pennsylvania. Thanks for that. But anyway, here's the modern city of Izmir. And actually tomorrow they are heading to the city of Pergamum. So it's kind of fun that I'm talking about it tonight. She's going to be there tomorrow and she's going to Thyatira as well. So tonight we're going to do Pergamum. There's a lot to talk about with Pergamum. And I actually have a question to ask you. Because there is so much material to cover with Pergamum, and frankly, I had a very busy week for several reasons, I thought we'd just limit it to that tonight. But then that means there's still four more letters to cover, which I can run through them next week, or I could come back another week after Easter if you guys are willing to show up for that. So think about it. Talk amongst yourselves and maybe you can tell the pastor what you would prefer, so you don't have to actually tell me right now. But anyway, I'm willing to come back if you guys want to kind of slow it down and don't have to rush through it. So I figured I would slow it down and at least, you know, go calmly through Pergamum. So anyway, just to let you know that. Okay, you ready? City of Pergamum, yes. Here we go. I love maps. I've told you that before. And so as you can see, if I were a postal worker and I was literally carrying the letter, then I would have left the tiny island of Patmos, I would have come over here to Ephesus, let them read it, drop it off, they make copies, right? Mm-hmm. Then I would have gone up to Smyrna, I'm serious about making copies. They read it, they make some copies, all right, great. Then we're gonna head north and we're going to Pergamum, which is actually a little bit inland. So the first two cities were coastal ones and this one is about 16 miles inland. But it's quite beautiful. I can't wait to show you pictures of this one. And like the other two cities before, it was pretty famous. It was very proud of its heritage. It was a rival for honor with Smyrna and with Ephesus. So really, it started to become a big deal back around the Hellenistic period. So it's actually the kingdom of Pergamon at one point. And so you can see at its height, like this is the area that it spanned. So it covered a good bit of the western part of Anatolia. And by the way, during that point, it was ruled by the Attalid dynasty. So you can see this guy's head. So people think that this is probably Attalus the First. So anyway, they ruled for a while, and they were really good friends with Rome, big supporters of Rome in several different wars, and so when Attalus III died, he bequeathed the whole kingdom to Rome. That's a pretty nice inheritance, I guess. So he turned over everything to Rome, And again, they kind of welcomed the Romans in, not really conquering heroes because it was just bequeathed to them. And so since this was the first area that Rome, I guess, owned is the best way to say it, in Western Asia Minor, this became the capital of their new Roman province of Asia. So this gives you a sense of where it was. And so they were the capital until they lost that privilege, and the capital moved down to Ephesus when Rome was able to take over that area as well. So you can see why there would be a little bit of rivalry already with Ephesus, because they lost the capital to them. So it's kind of a sore point. But one thing that they had to brag about was this. They said that they were the most famous city in Asia, and Pliny, who is an ancient historian, agreed with them. And so we know that he's quoted as saying, it's the most famous place. And it was a truly amazing place because it was built on this Acropolis. So big, huge hill. You can kind of zoom in and see some of the things up there. I've been showing you this picture a lot, actually, because I've been showing you this as an example of the imperial cult. We'll talk about this temple a little bit later. But it was a truly amazing city, and sometimes it's hard to really get an idea of it. So I love the reconstructions, and so I made, I scanned this in today, and I had to do it in two parts, so it's not necessarily the best, but I like this postcard. I bought it when I was in Pergamum once because I just love the reconstructed drawing. So you can see the Acropolis up on the top of the hill. And that was there before Rome took over. A lot of those buildings were there before Rome took over. They even started a new city down at the base of the Acropolis. So it's a really beautiful place, full of temples. We're going to talk about those, dedicated both to gods and to the Caesars. And I don't know, it's one of my favorite places. So if you ever get a chance to go, definitely go to Pergamum. Now, here's a quiz for you. Ready? Ephesus had a really important patron goddess. Who was it? Oh, I must not be a very good teacher. Nobody? Had a big temple in Ephesus.
I know what she looks like.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yes, yeah. We said it 2 weeks ago and last week. What's that? Artemis. Good job. Yes, Artemis. Yes, Artemis of Ephesus.
I remembered that. Because you didn't want to say Pledge of Allegiance. But you carried her in your pocket.
Yes.
I thought that was unusual.
Well, I had to bring her so you could see her. It's show and tell around here, right? So I brought the little, yes, I brought an example of a silversmith's work so you can see it, but yeah. Okay, Artemis of Ephesus. Well, every city had patron gods and goddesses, and they usually had one that was more important than the others. So, this is another A. Can you think of any other gods that start with an A? Not Apollo. It's
Athena? Athena?
Yes. She was the patron goddess of Pergamum. Okay? And what was the Athena goddess of? Do you remember your Greek mythology if you had to study that a long time ago?
Wisdom.
Well, she was a warrior goddess, yeah. So lots of times cities that were in a strategic defense position would adopt Athena as their patron goddess. If you head north from Pergamum, then on the coast, you'll find Assos, one of my favorite cities in the world, and it's got another temple to Athena. She was the goddess there, and again, it's on the coast, and it's a real strategic point, so you know they adopted her in part because she is a goddess of war. What else is she the goddess of? Can you give anything? I know, it's tough to reach back to those classes that you may or may not have ever taken, right?
Wisdom, isn't it?
Wisdom, yes! Yes, the preacher gets a point. Hey. Excellent, yes. So she is the goddess of wisdom. So it's not surprising that when they built a temple and actually a whole sanctuary complex to her, well, I'll zoom in so you can see it here. I like this model, the reconstruction. Isn't that cool? So they built something that included a library. So I think that's actually pretty cool. So here is her temple right here. I'm going to zoom in a little bit more so you can see it. So this is her temple, but this is actually the entire sanctuary complex. And so this is the library that kind of wraps around it here. And this is what it looks like today. I know. Sometimes we have really amazing buildings that are left or that are reconstructed at least, and sometimes we just get kind of the base and, you know, a few pillars here or there. And the people standing in the middle of this, I led a tour of adults in 2015, and there were only 13 of them on the trip, and somehow 5 out of the 13 happened to be librarians. So, these are my librarians standing in the Library of Pergamum, which was actually very, very famous. It was considered the second library after the Library of Alexandria. So if you've ever heard of that one, very famous in antiquity. So this was number 2. And one thing that I find really interesting, and I wish I could have brought some examples in, but they are boxed up somewhere in my basement and I could not find them. But books, well, the precursor of books, scrolls, and then codex when they came out, they were at first written on papyrus. Has anybody ever seen papyrus before? Maybe some of you. Mm-hmm. So papyrus was made out of the stalks that you find by the Nile. And if you were to slit those open, then the inside pulpy bit, which is called byblos, is what they would take, and they would, you know, use that pulp and lay it out in the sun, and when it dries, they would do strips back and forth of this pulpy bit. Then it would make these sheets of papyrus that they would write on. And since it was made out of byblos, later on we get this word book, byblos, which is Bible, right? Bible is a collection of books. So actually the Bible's name goes all the way back to the Nile. So they kind of had the market on the precursor of paper, and that's where everybody would get it from, right? Well, then somebody smart came up with another idea, and they said, well, we don't want to have to go to Egypt all the time to get something to write on. Let's figure something else out. They'd been using clay. You've probably seen that before, and people would write in wet clay. That takes a long time, though, and sometimes you don't always have access to clay. So what they started doing was skinning animals, the hides of sheep, goats, and they made something that's called parchment out of them. And I brought this picture because this is just an example of how long it would take to make books in the ancient world. So, sorry. It took 40 animals to make enough parchment to produce one copy of the Pentateuch, which is the first 5 books of the Bible, the Torah. So Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. 40 sheep. So imagine how long that would take to make those. Anyway, Pergamum, it kind of becomes known for its parchment, and that's what they use. And after a while, Alexandria gets so mad at them, you know, that they've stopped buying the papyrus from them and that people are starting to use the parchment, that they kind of start a precursor of a trade war. So this is the early trade war, and they say, nope, no more parchment for you. We're not sending any more to you. So they cut off the supply, papyrus. They cut off the supply of papyrus to all of Anatolia. They wouldn't send it anywhere in Anatolia anymore. So I just thought that was interesting to see, like, the rivalry that goes on between these cities and the types of economic fights that they would have back then. So Athena, first goddess, it's really important. Second god that's really important is Dionysus. Do you know what he's the god of? Parties, yeah, he's the god of parties, wine, revelry, that sort of thing, but he's also the god of, it's in the background, theaters, like he's the patron god of the arts, and here we go, see, he's having a good time here, wine, celebration. And so if you, we have another little picture of this model. So looking at it from this side, you can see the huge theater that they had, and it was one of the steepest in the world, if not the steepest, because it's built into the side of this cliff. And at the very base of it, you can see this is a little temple to Dionysus, which makes sense because it's put right next door to the theater. And here you can kind of see the remains of the steps, and there's the base of it as well. And one of my very favorite things there is the theater. Like, you have to kind of get over the vertigo from walking down this thing. This is what it's like walking down, so to give you some sense. And then, of course, walking up is also a challenge. But it's an amazing view. It's beautiful from there. So I told you the Adelaide dynasty was the one that ruled before the Romans came in, and there were two brothers that ruled for a long time, and they wanted to make this city amazing. They wanted to make it like Athens. You know, again, Athena is their patron goddess. So they tried to make it beautiful. They wanted to have, I guess it would be the ancient equivalent of the Paris over in Anatolia. So they wanted to be known for all the Greek culture and the arts and everything. So it was really beautiful. All of the money that they spent on building things, bringing in artists and artisans to make things, amazing. You can't have temples without having one to the king of all the gods, right? So they also had something that we think was dedicated to Zeus. It may have been dedicated to both Zeus and to Athena, but it's called the Altar of Zeus, and it's right here. Can you see this building here? So that's the Altar of Zeus. If you zoom in this way, you can kind of see it. Remember the shape of it. That's going to come back up in a little bit. Sadly, though, that is not there today. This is the base that is still there. And the reason why there's just a base there, actually the reason why there's just a base of a lot of the different buildings in Pergamum is because of the Germans. So the German archaeologists that went there first dismantled a lot of the things that they found and took them back to Berlin. And there, if you were to go to Berlin, you would find the Museum of Pergamum today. And you would see things reconstructed there. I mean, wouldn't it be amazing if that was still in Turkey and you could actually go and see it on the hillside? So this is the Altar of Zeus. Amazing, right? Seriously, I'm amazed by it. So there are a lot of things that Pergamum was famous for. It's got this amazing library. It's got this amazing theater. It's got this really cool altar to Zeus that's going to come back up. But one other thing that it's really famous for has to do with this god. You could probably guess what he's the god of, maybe, if you see the symbol that's with him. Any guess?
Healing.
Healing, yes. So our modern symbols for medicine, you know, we always have that snake that goes around the staff. So it comes from this guy, Asclepius. So he was the god of healing. And in the ancient world, they would make things called Asclepions, which were these centers where people would go for healing, just like you said. And this is the sacred way that they would walk in, and it would have been colonnaded, you know, the big tall columns. And then you can't quite see it very well, but over here there's a theater because they thought that the arts were therapeutic, so they were way ahead of their time. They had some other things there. You would go and you would stay. It was kind of like a spa. Maybe that's a good sort of comparison. And at the spa, you would sleep there, and hopefully Asclepius would visit you in your dreams and heal you. But another thing they had there is they had the priest, kind of an early version of therapist, who would walk and talk with you. They literally would walk and talk with you. And this is one of the coolest things that we saw. So they would have the patients walk down underground, as you see my students walking down. This is where they're going. And when they walked underground, then the therapist, priest, would stand above, and there's some holes above the ground, and they would talk to the person, telling them to walk towards the light. You see the light at the end of the tunnel? And as they walked, they would talk to their patient about different things. And as they walked, there's water that's flowing through here, and they put some kind of nice hallucinogenic drug sort of things in the water, and they've got steam going on, so the patients are getting really loosened up. It's an interesting sort of therapy. And once they got to the end of this long hallway, they came to this circular area, and their priest therapist would meet them, and they would walk in a circle, just walk and talk. So again, kind of this ancient version of counseling, in a sense. So people would go there to be healed. Some people were, and if they were, they would often make little charms or images of the part of the body that had been healed, and it was famous all over the Roman Empire. Now, I've told you about the gods that are there, but something that I haven't told you about yet, that we've talked about every time, is the imperial cult, right? So you knew that that was coming. Now, Pergamum, they have bragging rights because they had the very first Neokoros in Asia. Now, do you guys remember what Neokoros stands for? Lots of quizzes today.
The temple builder?
Yeah, well, it's the temple sweeper, the temple keeper. And why did you get that name? Why would a city earn that title? Do you guys remember? It's because they had been granted the right by one of the emperors to build a temple, usually in their honor. So the very first one was built in honor of Caesar Augustus. Okay, so he's the first one who gets a temple over in Asia, and it's actually dedicated to him and to the goddess Roma. And you can actually see that on the coins from Pergamum, they wanted to brag about this, right? Because these images, these symbols travel everywhere. They don't just stay locally. They go all across the empire as our money travels today, right? Because you're always exchanging it and it moves from place to place. So this was a symbol of honor, of pride, of bragging rights. And so you can see here's another example of the temple here, and you've actually got Augustus standing in his temple. Yeah. Maybe this is already making some connections in your mind to some of the things you hear about later on in Revelation. Hint, hint. So the second temple that they got, and this is actually after the time of John, but just to give you some idea of how prevalent this was the Temple of Trajan. And you can still go today and you can see some of it right up on the top. I mean, it really dominates the landscape up on top of the Acropolis. And, okay, don't judge me too much, but we did let our students climb on some of the antiquities. We probably shouldn't have done that. They were actually much more lenient back in those days. But here's some of my students when I first took them years ago. It's an amazing temple. It's an amazing place to be. Here's one of my students to give you some idea of the size and scale of these columns. I don't know. Hannah, do you have anything that you would say about that from going to visit the city or going to visit the temple? I mean, what were your impressions when you first saw it?
Yeah, well, it's huge. It's really hard to capture it in pictures. Even the looking at the Acropolis from far away, you're in the Asclepion, the hospital part, and you're looking up at the hill and you just see these tiny remnants of a temple, and they stand out so much, and you know that it must have been so impressive. Then the view from the Acropolis in Pergamum is really just breathtaking, and to be there when it's in its full glory would have been really, really impressive for the people at the time.
Yeah, it's the most famous city, the most amazing city, you know. They have these titles that they like to give themselves. And this is what it may have looked like in its full glory, to give you some idea. What I always found impressive, and what's still there, let me see if I can back up here. You can still see like the supportive arches that they had to construct to have this flat basis upon which to build the temple. And have any of you guys actually been to Israel before? Okay, yeah, so there's something similar at the Temple Mount. This is just for free, for fun. So they had the first temple that was there. It gets destroyed by the Babylonians, right? After they come back, they build a second temple, not nearly as nice, not nearly as grand. So when Herod, yes, that King Herod who tried to kill baby Jesus, when he takes over, he's got all these big building plans. And so he wants to make something even more glorious, more beautiful than what Solomon had made. But you're kind of limited by the mountain space, right? So he decides that he's going to first build out on this platform and make these amazing supports to be able to do this, because you don't want to cut off the top of the mountain because it's holy. You don't touch that, right? So he builds on top of it and around it. So this gives you kind of some idea of the engineering skills that they had, and this is similar to what they ended up doing in Jerusalem to build the Temple Mount there as well. I mean, it's pretty impressive that they were able to do that. So this is what it would have looked like, and here's kind of the base that you see that they had to construct before they even start building the temple on top of it. Now, that just gives you a taste of what the city of Pergamum is like, some things you even see if you went to today, and a lot of these things have connections in the letter itself that's written to Pergamum. So, here is the letter. You have Bibles in front of you. What I want you to do is, with that handout that you have, is to try to fill it out with your table. Look at it. You're already getting a sense of the structure. You see that repeated every week, right? So use that structure, fill it out, go ahead and start talking in your table about what goes where and what you notice in this letter. So I'll give you 5 or so minutes to do that. If you really want, I can play some Gaither music for you too. That might be a little bit more fun.
Each of those descriptions goes back to the Savior.
It's just some subset of it?
Yeah, well, the scribes and great detail, and it's one of the things. From a sharp to a sword.
So are there seven different things that are described in
Revelation? I'm not sure, but I'm guessing. The first and the last was at Smyrna. And Thyatira, the son of God who has eyes like a flame of fire.
Yeah, that's all from
1:12 through 17 or so.
It was awesome.
It's like a literary device.
Yeah, yeah.
You describe this very strange looking person, and then you write seven letters, each of which draws from one of the descriptions. My take on the warnings and promises is that's a little bit somewhere else.
Yeah. Yeah, it means there's right around seven different ways that he's described in chapter one. Yeah. I mean, most of the things have been so far.
Oh, yeah, all
Yeah. Well, depending on just how imprisoned he was, you have a lot of time.
It's a long time.
I'm not sure you've met her hand. Her husband
was I wonder if she was talking about the elusiveness.
Yeah.
The water and Pergamon. So I wonder if John spent some time over there walking through the tunnel and being talked to by somebody on the top.
It was really cool to go to the Esplanade and see the.
And it was good. She talked about it in terms of almost like a rule, but it was, the assumption was that the talk there had physical.
And I would say that people would agree with that now, but I think that also in less scientifically based cultures, a lot of people think that all of their sicknesses come from the gods and from people putting spells and so on.
I'm not sure what that means.
I am lucky that I am a pharmacist.
Did too little or too much. I was never entirely sure how much they needed for the group work. But you had a chance to read it yourselves, try to figure it out for yourself, to talk amongst yourselves, yeah? Okay. All right, good. All right, I'm going to read it out loud, and then we're going to go through the different parts together and talk about what they possibly mean. Maybe you've already had a good idea to start thinking through that yourselves, which is good, because symbols are multifaceted. I definitely think there are better interpretations, but there are many interpretations, and they're meant to do that, I think. So what it says to you, you may notice something that somebody else doesn't. So I look forward to hearing what you guys think. So let's read it. And to the angel of the church in Pergamum write, these are the words of him who has the sharp two-edged sword. I've underlined some of the key things we're going to talk about. I know where you are living, where Satan's throne is, yet you are holding fast to my name, and you did not deny your faith in me, even in the days of Antipas, my witness, my faithful one, who was killed among you, where Satan lives. But I have a few things against you. You have some there who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the people of Israel, so that they would eat food sacrificed to idols and practice fornication. So you also have some who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Repent then, if not, I will come to you soon and make war against them with the sword of my mouth. Let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. To everyone who conquers, I will give some of the hidden manna, and I will give a white stone. And on the white stone is written a new name that no one knows except the one who receives it. All right, clear as mud, right? Yes? Excellent. We can go home now, you know. I'll get to go put my feet up early. All right, let's start. So the first one's easy. To the angel of the church in Pergamum. That's what we've been talking about. Great. And I remember we talked about this earlier. I love that there's a specific message to each one of these churches, that it's been individualized, tailored to these churches. I think that's lovely. Now, the descriptive statement of Jesus, of Christ, from that first vision, these are the words of, who is he this time? How's he described? Excellent. Him who has the sharp two-edged sword. So we're going to start with that image first. And remember, again, here's a reminder what the vision looks like and all the different pieces of the vision. We're going to focus, of course, on this double-edged sword coming out of the mouth. And again, I love Christian art and interpretations of the Bible, so I thought I would bring a few in that really highlight the sword coming out of the mouth. Yes, because I love the Brick Testament, the Lego Bible, as some people call it. 10 years the pastor spent constructing these things. This is amazing. Or this. I mean, this is a very prominent sword, right? Or this. I mean, they take it very literal in these drawings that they do. Or this one's a little bizarre. It's interesting. It's got some other things going on there. And here's a more traditional one, but you see they've all got the sword coming out of the mouth. Now, here's another quiz for you. Swords show up lots of different times in the Bible. When they show up symbolically, can you think of what they meant or some of the times when a sword has already been used, maybe in other parts of the Bible?
In battle.
Well, yeah, that's a literal one, so a literal sword. What about when it's used in some kind of symbolic way?
Well, in the putting on the armor of Christ.
Yes, yes. You guys remember in Ephesians, it talks about this armor you can put on, and you have the sword of the Spirit. Good, yes, okay. And what is the sword of the Spirit? What are you going to slay with? God's authority, God's word. It's often equated with God's word. And so there are different interpretations of the word word, the word word. It means a lot of different things. God's message, God's authority. Jesus is called the Word in the Gospel of John. This is the same John coming along. Anyway, there's a connection between Word and Jesus for sure. So Word, message, I like that one. What's really interesting, here's just a fun side note for you. This word for sword here is one Greek word. And when John uses it in the book of Revelation, he tends to use it symbolically because he has another Greek word for sword, the literal kind, the makara. And so when he's talking about a literal sword, he uses that word. This is the symbolic kind. So Revelation uses a lot of war imagery. You probably already know that. And so sometimes people are like, so is God really violent? Is Jesus really violent? How do we deal with that? What's interesting is this sword, you know, is symbolic. So Jesus slays not with battle sword, but with the word of God, with the message of God, with the truth of God. There are lots of different interpretations of it, but it's definitely symbolic. So this isn't a warrior Jesus, even the warrior depictions that you get. Like, how does Jesus slay? With the truth. And a lot of the themes in this particular letter have to do with justice, because of course the sword, you see it even in some of our imagery in the courthouse, you know. Swords are a symbol of justice, right? And so in some ways, the message that they're getting is that, yeah, Rome holds the sword over you. Rome sets up justices. They have judges that come by. They're these Asiarchs. Don't worry about it. But just because Rome has rule over you, you think Rome has the ultimate justice, you think Rome has the ultimate power, Jesus is the one that actually has justice. Jesus is actually the one who's going to do judgment. Like back in the vision with Ephesus, if you remember that one, he's walking amongst the seven golden lampstands and he's holding, you know, the seven stars, which, you know, Caesar held the seven stars in his hands. Caesar had control of the universe is the claim. Counterclaim, no, Jesus does. Jesus holds the universe. And then in that letter to Smyrna, think about it. It was the one who was the person who came back from the dead. Caesar doesn't hold life and death. Jesus does. Like, who's in charge of life and death? The one who came back from the grave. More powerful than the Caesar. Who's in charge of justice? Ultimately, it's going to be Jesus. Yes, you're afraid. This is the one letter where we actually get a name of a martyr because people have actually died. You know, there actually has been Roman justice that's come down on them. But the true one who gives out justice is God, Jesus. Okay, so let's go on to the body. Here, remember we always get compliments and or complaints. There are a couple churches that get either one or the other. Remember Smyrna, it just had the compliments, no complaints. And Pergamum's going to get both. All right, so first we're going to deal with the compliments. And I put endurance up here because have you noticed this is a theme? Like this is something that he keeps complimenting all of these churches in Asia Minor. Like you are enduring, you're holding up. And it always starts with, I know. So what does Jesus know about this church in Pergamum?
It's not a good place to live. I mean, you are holding fast to my name. You did not deny your faith, even in the days of Antipas, my witness, my faithful one, who is still among you, where Satan lives. It's difficult to live there and be a moral person.
Yeah.
But they're holding on.
Yes. Yes, and that's putting it mildly. I mean, he calls it the place where Satan dwells. I mean, it can't get much worse than that, can it? So yes, here are some of the things. Living right where Satan's throne is. We'll talk about that in a minute. You're holding on to my name, and we've already seen this my name in the other letters. So to bear someone's name is to have their identity. So they're holding on to Christ's name, right? So Christ is the mark that they bear, not the beast, as we would see later on in Revelation. So they're holding on to that name, and because of that, well, they're living in Satan's place, so that doesn't quite go well together. You didn't break faith with me even at the time that Antipas, my faithful witness, was killed among you where Satan lives. All right, well, let's talk about Satan first, all right? So who is Satan? What is Satan? Let's start with Satan's throne. I don't think I've ever said Satan that many times in a row before. All right, so there are different contenders for Satan and for Satan's throne. You ready? This is one that you already saw. Did you notice the shape of that altar? Does it at all bring to mind an image of maybe a throne? Yeah, can you see it? So this is one of the contenders. So Satan could be referring to Zeus or just all of the gods collectively, you know, something that is against God, that is not God, worshiping another god. So definitely this is the place where there are all these temples that we saw to the gods. So it's possible that Satan's throne, and you can kind of see it up here. I mean, it's very prominent on the landscape, right? And so they would be burning incense, probably burning other kinds of sacrifice. We'll get to meat in a little bit. It's something that you see. It's something that you notice. So definitely this could be in their minds. It could be this guy. Who is this guy? The healing one. Yes, Asclepius. Okay. Well, why could it be Asclepius? Can you guys think about like what could be any connections that might make you think of Satan with Asclepius? The snake, good. And serpents in Revelation are already connected with Satan, right? So some people think it's possible that it's pointing towards these Asclepions, because who heals? Well, ultimately God is the healer, not Asclepius, right? So it's a challenge to God's authority. So some people think maybe that's what they're talking about. Maybe the snake, you know, is brought to mind. Could be the imperial cult again, because again, this is the first place where they had a temple to Augustus. So is it just referring to a Caesar or the Caesars or, you know, by proxy, all of Rome, like Rome, this imperial monster, is Satan in a way? You're living where Satan's authority is strong. You've seen that play out with this one witness who's already been martyred. So again, symbols are multifaceted. There are lots of different interpretations for them, some better than others. These are probably the best contenders and what most biblical scholars would go with. All right, something else that came up there was this guy, Antipas. So, I didn't show you this picture before, but if you were sitting in the theater and you looked out and a little to the left, then you would see the ruins of the stadium. And so we've talked about this already. You've heard stories of Christians who were martyred in stadiums, right? Thrown to the wild beast, killed by gladiators, all sorts of different things. The Christian legend here is that Antipas was sewn into a brazen bowl, is what the church father writes, and then burned alive inside the skin of this brazen bowl. So that's the tradition about how Antipas dies. We don't know much more about this than that tradition. Witness, that word in Revelation, it's the same word that we now use for martyr, because to martyrio is to witness. And because of their witness, because they are bearing the name of Jesus, bearing witness, they end up being a martyr. And here's the first connection we kind of see between that and how that word is going to shift to kind of mean something else. So those who are faithful witnesses often end up as martyrs, and that's where that word comes from. This is just a suggestion if you're looking for something to read. One of my books is actually, I like to read fictionalizations of the Bible. And so Bruce Longenecker, who is an excellent New Testament scholar, he was actually my supervisor when I was doing my PhD. Bruce Longenecker, Longenecker. It's a long name. He wrote a fictionalized version of the story. So it's called The Lost Letters of Pergamum, if you want to go and look it up. And it's great because he uses this idea of the letters that you already see in Revelation. And he presents like a story built around Antipas writing letters to Luke, who wrote the Gospel of Luke. And they're writing letters and exchanging ideas. And it's definitely a conversion narrative. But it's a really interesting story, and it gets you back into that time and what it would have probably been like for these early Christians. So if you're looking for something to read and you like historical fiction, that would be my suggestion. So we talked a little bit about persecution the other day and the different types of persecution that they could endure. It could just be slander, right? It could be economic, could be social. It could be the threat of violence, being jailed. Here we get the threat of death itself. And even in the face of death, some of them were still holding strong. They were surviving. They were overcoming. This is the other word that we get a lot in Revelation. But not everyone was, right? Here's the complaint. But I have a few things against you. Here we go. Some there who follow Balaam's teaching. Balaam had taught Balak to trip up the Israelites so that they would eat food sacrificed to idols and commit sexual immorality. In the same way, you have some who taught the Nicolaitans teaching. Again, this is one of those, all right, clear as mud. You got to know a little bit of Old Testament history to even start, you know, breaking this one down. So let's start there. Does anybody remember who Balaam is? It's a really fun story.
The donkey.
The donkey, yes. You guys got it. See, here's a picture. So, in the story, of course, King Balak hires Balaam to bless him, but to curse the Israelites. And as he's, you know, going to do this, you have an angel that stands in the way, but only the donkey can see it, right? And so the donkey actually starts speaking to tell Balaam, no, there's this angel that's going to kill you. With a sword, please note, you know, some of these symbols come up in the story, so there are a lot of swords in this letter. And so he has to turn around, and he doesn't do that. That's one part of the story, right? So I liked reading some of the different commentators, because one of them said, Balak and Balaam prefigure the beast in Revelation as a false king and a false prophet. So they're kind of prototypes of this, all right? So the two going together, hand in hand. Something else that a commentator had to say, I just love the way he put it. He said, Balaam, a typical example of the mercenary spirit, because he's getting paid to do this job, to bless Balak and to curse Israel, and the father of religious syncretism. Big word. We're going to talk about that one in a minute, and you're probably like, the father of religious syncretism? Like, what in the world does this story have to do with religious syncretism? Well, this is really fun Bible trivia, but can you think of any other places in the Old Testament that Balaam gets mentioned? I feel like we're doing one of those Bible quizzing sort of things that some of my students grew up doing in the Anabaptist churches. Can you think of anywhere else that Balaam shows up?
It's not related to Baal.
Actually, it is. Yeah.
Oh, it is.
That is part of this.
It's tried to be.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so Baal, this other Canaanite god, he actually helps to induce them to worship Baal. And the way that he does this, it's this whole story of how he talks some Moabite women into seducing some of the Israelite men. And because they're fornicating with these women, they start worshiping the gods of these foreign women. And then this whole thing happens. There's a plague that breaks out, and until this Phineas goes and like kills somebody, it doesn't start. It's a very bloody and violent story. Again, swords and violence and things in this story too. But anyway, the connection there with Balaam is that he is said to be the one who pushes the women to do this and tells them to lead the men astray. So that's the connection. Now, these guys are connected with this name, and we've talked about this name before. Remember the Nike? Yeah? What does Nike mean? Do you remember that one? Well, the advertisers are going to be so proud because that marketing campaign is amazing and it has worked. You remember that. All right. Well, let's try to rebrand it. Nike also means victory, right? The goddess Nike was the goddess of victory. Okay? Nike means conquering, having victory. So part of the name of Nicolaitans, actually it's really kind of interesting because Laos is people, and so it could just be the conqueror of people. So it could be symbolic, the name Nicolaitan. It's kind of ironic if you think about it, because here they're being accused not of conquering, but of compromising. So it's kind of ironic, I think. So the Nicolaitans, we've already seen them in Ephesus. If you remember, this was something that Ephesus got charged with. They said, but you have this in your favor. You hate what the Nicolaitans are doing. So they had some who had broken off and were doing some kind of heretical thing, which I also hate. So we've already seen this. And I don't know if you remember me saying before, but I mentioned when we were talking about Ephesus, that a lot of people think this was an early form of Gnosticism. And so it's been connected with that. And Gnosticism, to simplify it, is basically an early heresy in the church where they really focused on the spirit and not on the body. So they said Jesus, you know, came in the spirit but not really in the flesh. And so that seemed like he was human, but he wasn't really. He's playing a big joke on us. He's really just spirit. Then there are a lot of things that would fall out of that. If Jesus wasn't really incarnated, if the flesh isn't actually important, because they thought that flesh was bad, spirit good, flesh bad, then does it really matter how we treat one another? This is why some people think that in John's communities they were having trouble with the love, too, because if people think the flesh doesn't matter, then what I do in the flesh doesn't matter. So if I don't treat people well, doesn't matter. If I want to sleep around, doesn't matter. If I want to eat food sacrificed to idols, doesn't matter, because I'm doing it in the flesh, and whatever I do in the flesh doesn't matter. It's just the spirit that matters, right? So this is kind of, in church history, what he has been accused of. And he was actually one of the first converts. If you remember back in Acts, when they appointed seven people, one of whom was Stephen, we mentioned him the other day, and Prochorus, who was the guy who was with John taking down the notes, this is the third one of the seven. So Nicholas was said to be one of the people. So anyway, he ends up with heresy attributed to him. And this heresy is not only connected with Gnosticism, but it's connected with that big word I said a minute ago, syncretism. So this is something that he has in common with Balaam, because basically syncretism is the bad version of mixing Christianity with culture. I mean, Christianity always mixes with culture, and that's part of it. It's an incarnated religion, because we think that the flesh does actually matter, that culture is good, that culture is important, but some aspects of culture aren't. And so when you take those bad aspects and compromise with it and bring it into your religion and make this little mixture, that's bad syncretism. So basically, what we think is going on is this group of Christians is saying, oh, you know, we don't have to actually abstain from like Caesar worship. And remember, when you go to worship the Caesar, that's the place where they have these different sacrifices. Lots of them were meat. And in fact, in antiquity, that's the place that you're probably going to get meat from. It would be almost impossible to avoid meat that had been sacrificed to idols unless you became a vegetarian. And frankly, that's what they ate most of the time anyway. Meat's only on special occasions. But you get it from these altars. In fact, I brought this picture. I didn't take a really good one. You can see it's right around the corner here, but somebody else did. Thank you, Internet. This is the altar that's right outside of the temple to Trajan. And so they would sacrifice the meat, and then they would distribute it. So how do you avoid doing that? And then the Galatians are basically saying, there's no problem. What's the problem with eating this? And maybe you remember Paul's letter to the Corinthians. They're dealing with the same thing. Go and read 1 Corinthians 8 through 11 because they're having the same problem of food sacrificed to idols. What do we do about it? Well, John takes a very hardline stance and thinks that's a no-no because that's participating in worshiping the emperor if you're eating this meat that's sacrificed to him or if you're eating the meat that's sacrificed to any of the other gods. So maybe it's just taking part of the pagan festivities that are going on there. Maybe the food is just symbolizing all of those in totality. And on a side note, they still have festivals there today. This is now modern day Bergamum is what it's called today. And we happen to stumble across a little festival. And I didn't think it was so bad. I let my students participate. Hopefully that wasn't bad syncretism there. But still, they have festivals today. It wasn't a religious one. So one of my colleagues, he likes to call this eating the forbidden fruit. So you're not supposed to eat the forbidden fruit, right? He also calls the fornication part being in bed with the enemy. Because throughout the Bible, fornication, adultery is often a symbol for idolatry. The two are connected to one another because it's like cheating on God. Does that make sense? Worshiping somebody else, it's like if you're cheating on your spouse, you're cheating on God. So this is the best picture I could get for you. We also happen to stumble across these reenactors who are all dressed up. So I figured, well, they'll work well for our temple prostitutes because that's a whole other problem. Because a lot of these temples had prostitutes and that was considered a holy thing. So if you go in and you do your business with the prostitute, that's actually a holy and good thing, right? So the Nicolaitans were perhaps saying, what's the problem? You know, if flesh doesn't matter, we can kind of do whatever, so why do we really need to abstain from those things too and to separate ourselves from, you know, what's going on in culture? So this seems to be one of the major problems. So they get a warning, right? Not a promise. They get a warning. So change your hearts and lives. That's something we've already heard the other cities being told. Change. Repent. If you don't, I am coming to you soon. And I will make war on them with the sword that comes from my mouth. Okay? Again, that sword being used there, it's a symbolic one. But the sword that comes out of the mouth, I wish I still had the little picture of the inkwell that I often have down here because seeing them juxtaposed together today, I was thinking, we always say the pen is mightier than the sword. You know, the spoken word of God mightier than even this literal physical sword. So anyway, he's going to come. He is the judge. He's the one who makes a final pronouncement on them and what they're doing. And finally, we get this conclusion. Let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. So we've gotten that in all three of the letters so far. And what is the Spirit saying to the churches? Well, here's the concluding exhortation and promise. I will give those who emerge victorious. You see that word again? Victory, conquering. Some of the hidden manna to eat. I will also give to each of them a white stone with a new name written on it, which no one knows except the one who receives it. Okay? Did you happen to talk in your groups about what you thought that stuff meant or any ideas? Because, again, symbols are fluent. They can mean different things. Maybe you see something that other people haven't. So what are some of the things you saw or noticed?
The manna comes from heaven.
Tell us about the manna, because, again, you got to know something about the Old Testament to interpret this one. What was the manna?
There were certain conditions under to eat the manna. You had to consume it in one day. Mm-hmm. It would get stale. Mm-hmm. It meant complete dependence on God to feed them.
Yeah. Most of you may remember the story when the Israelites are wandering around in the wilderness and the desert. They don't really have access to a lot of food, definitely no stores. So they're completely reliant on God, who would rain down manna. You hear this manna from heaven phrase. It's existence, even in popular culture, right? So they were dependent on God. God fed them. God took care of them. Lots of times you see this repeated in Revelation. I will provide for you. I will take care of you, right? And there, in some of the literature from the Second Temple period, I mentioned the temple earlier when they reconstructed it, some of that literature said that in the Messianic age, that just means when the Messiah comes again, that manna will again rain down from heaven, that it was a sign of the coming of the Messiah. So that could be part of it too. When Jesus comes, when the Messiah comes, the manna rains down again, because that was an expectation for them at that point.
I thought it was interesting. It says some of the hidden manna. So either there's plenty of it there to be shared, or some is being kept in reserve, or only some will get the hidden manna.
Yep. It's difficult to interpret things sometimes. Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. This is why biblical scholars have a job, is what you're doing right here. You know, parsing apart all the words and trying to figure out all the different meanings. What else can I tell you? Oh, just a minute ago, the Nicolaitans were being accused of eating that food sacrificed to idols, so they're eating the bad food. Don't eat the bad food. I'll give you the good food, right? So here's kind of a contrast that's going on. Yeah.
I'm looking for how it would work, but is the hidden manna related to the manna put aside because of the Sabbath in Exodus 16:22, they gathered as much, twice as much on the sixth day.
Yeah.
Because they were not to go gather on the Sabbath day.
That's possible.
So
I have to do some more digging and reading, but I like that, because that would connect it with the Sabbath rest as well. Some people also connect it with the Messianic banquet. You know, Jesus talks about banquets lots of times. So when God comes and the judgment happens, there's supposed to be this big, huge banquet that everybody's invited to. So, you know, basically, don't give in right now and eat the food that you want right now. Hold out for the better food. Hold out to be invited to this Messianic banquet where the manna will be provided. Yeah.
Was there some manna placed in the Ark of the Covenant?
Yes.
Also?
Mm-hmm. As well. Yeah. What about that white stone? Any idea about that one?
It makes me think of the buildings on the Acropolis there.
Yes. And that could be it, except that the reason that it's white is because the Germans kind of stripped away too much of the stone, so it probably wouldn't have looked white back in the day. That's just the German archaeologists cleaning a little bit too much. But yes, yes. I know, yeah. Can you think of anything else with stones? This one's a tough one. Well, tough in the sense that there are about six or seven different ideas that people have for it, all sorts of different things. Some of them were poor people would use stones as kind of meal tickets, and they could trade it for, and here's a connection with the food. So maybe that had something to do with the imagery there. I'm trying to think what else. There was also another idea that it's a rabbinic tradition. I'll just read it to you. A rabbinic tradition indicates that in the wilderness, precious stones and pearls fell from heaven with the manna. And so that's a connection between those two, too. It's possible. Some people think maybe it's a connection back again to the wilderness and the Israelites with Aaron. If you remember, he was the first priest, and he had to wear that vest with all of the stones, the precious jewels that are on it. So some people think maybe that's a connection as well. It would at least get those two metaphors together.
There's something written on that, too.
Yeah.
Ephod, was it? Is that the breastplate or something?
Yeah, on his breastplate. Yeah. I don't remember, but if you can look it up and tell us, that'd be good. Yeah.
I think white is often a sign of good things in the Bible. We use white liturgically at good times during the church year. And I think it also means sort of like joy and could mean victory.
Yeah.
But when I look at it, what I think is maybe the more important thing is the new name written on it. And, you know, you think of all the times that God gave people a new name. And so now he's giving us the opportunity to have a new name. And then I think those people who got new names, many of them became faithful followers.
Yeah.
But I don't know why, in those cases, it wasn't a secret name. So I don't know why they say that only the person who gets it will know what the new name is.
I've heard several different things about that.
GodQuestions.org says that in ancient Greece, jury members would cast a white stone to signify an acquittal, whereas a black stone might be guilty.
That's another one that people have come up with too. So maybe it has to do with we're being acquitted because we get the white stone. So that's been suggested as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm thinking, does it kind of foreshadow the beast and the number that on the forehead of the name of people and counteract that the white stone with a hidden name?
Yeah, because a lot of people suggest that the name that they bear could just be Christ. And the reason that it's hidden or something that not everybody can see or understand is that you have to be, you have to know Christ to know the name. That's been one interpretation. But yeah, those who bear the name of Christ are counter to those who bear the name of the beast. So yeah. Other thoughts that you guys had? Yeah?
Yeah. White is like purity.
Yep.
As opposed to what's happening in the temples with the prostitutes.
Good. Yeah, there definitely is a lot of contrast between these two. I think you're right. Yeah.
I'm searching for the word, but is the stone who signifies the number of temples that you have to the emperor? Is it white?
The
Neocoros? The Neocoros, that stone you've shown us.
Are you talking about the coins?
No. You showed us a stone in one of the cities.
Okay.
That said, we have two, or we have three, or we're better than them.
Yeah, that was, it just was an inscription on the stone where they were bragging about having it. So, yeah.
Did it have a name, or did it have a name on it?
If it does, I don't know. It was just an inscription, bragging. Me and Smyrna have three temples, and they only have two. I think it was just a pedestal that was written on the inscription. Changing your name actually did happen in antiquity. Octavian changed his name to Caesar Augustus. That's one example because he changed his name to that of a god. So some people did change their names in antiquity. I don't think this is necessarily correct, but it always reminds me of this allegory that I read growing up and that I loved. Did any of you guys ever read Hind's Feet on High Places before? Possibly Hannah Bernard. Yeah, it's a bit like Pilgrim's Progress, an allegory like that, but I just remember in the story, she starts out as Much Afraid is her name. It's an allegory, right? It's very straightforward. But by the end of it, she's given a new name, and I can't remember. It was something like Faith and Glory or something. I can't remember what it was, but it always reminds me of that. Like, part of it could be your name, your identity changes. Could also be because you are pledging allegiance to the Lamb, right? That your behavior is changing, your whole personhood is changing, and that identity is reflected in the new name, whether that's a Christ or whether it's something else. It could mean a lot of different things. So there are a lot of different theories on this one. Yeah?
Just going to say, just kind of in the footnotes here, it said that the hidden man on top of being a spiritual for believers, and also in white stone would represent the bearing of a new name for each person who is truly a believer in Christ, and new name in the heart.
Absolutely.
Is there a word?
There are a lot of ones about this.
Is there a word for white stone, or is it just two words, white and stone?
I'd have to get the Greek out and look that up. If you shoot me an email and remind me, I will.
I'm just wondering if the name Christopher means Christ bearer.
Yeah, it does.
Which, if Christopher has some relationship to that description, what's that? I'm not sure Christopher's Latin or
Greek.
Greek. So it would.
Yeah. Well, that's all I have for tonight. Do you guys have any questions about it? Probably many questions. All right, one or two questions you have about this. clear as mud. Like
it's an interesting.
Yeah.
With all the temple building, it would have taken up a lot of space.
Yep.
Was any of that living quarters? Did people, other than the apartments that were used for special things, but were they living quarters for servants or?
Before they were turned into temples.
Yeah, caretakers. Probably
not up on the Acropolis, on the hillside of the Acropolis. There were some houses. I'm going to try to see if I can get.
But there's,
It's more over here that there were some houses as you're coming up. That's not a great picture. Let's see if you can actually see it. I know, you're getting a review of everything. Probably not on the Acropolis.
No, the one picture there.
What, this one?
Even in some of the archway.
Mm-hmm. Probably not there. I mean, right behind the theater is that sanctuary to Athena, so that's a very sacred space, and people just wouldn't build houses there. But, I mean, that does make me think of Nero, who decides, well, if he did, set fire to Rome and to kind of clear out the riffraff so he had space to build, you know, his beautiful building, his nice new temple. So, I mean, he did something like that, but I don't think on this Acropolis that they would do that. Besides, it's difficult because how do you get water up there, right?
Right.
They're not too far from, there is a river that comes there, so they have a good river port that they can transport goods and get water from, but it's not up on top of the mountain, so you would have cisterns that would catch rainwater, but it's probably not the easiest place to live if you're trudging up and down with water and other things all the time. You're not going to grow things up on the rocky outcrop, so, yeah. Yeah.
The lake to build something like that, would that be tax dollars?
Well, a third to a fourth of the Roman Empire were slaves, so you definitely would have a workforce that you could use. I mean, maybe that's why we get so many beautiful buildings in antiquity, pyramids and things like this, because people weren't really being paid for that work. But there were also artisans. There is a town. When we talk about Laodicea, and that's the very last city, it's not too far from Laodicea, and it's called Aphrodisias, and it was actually kind of an artisan town. They were known all over the place for the beautiful statues that they would carve, and people would go there to have an apprenticeship. So, there were some slaves, but there were also some people that would make a living doing something like that, and if you remember me talking about the Attalid dynasty, like they were known for actually bringing in a lot of these artisans and hiring a lot of people to make, well, this was made during their time, this altar of Zeus. So it's a combination, I think.
Were the coins the same bag?
Yes. That's a good question. They had different values of coins. Back in that day, it still had to do with like how much silver is in it or how much gold is in it, so the actual weight of it. So that depends on the value, but they would try to make them, you know, similar. If they're minting these coins that are all supposed to be worth a certain value, it should have that amount of gold or that amount of silver or copper or whatever it is.
So they had a gold standard.
Yes, exactly. They did.
I'm just thinking of a year and a half ago, I was in the island of Rhodes, the Greek island of Rhodes, which of course is closer to Turkey than it is to Greece. I went to a small temple there. Of course, it's nothing like this size, but there was like an Acropolis up on the top, and then the hill slanted down gently, but not far from the Acropolis, that's where all the people live. So maybe not, I'm just thinking that because like when you go to a lot of those ancient towns, you know, they've got the Acropolis, they've got the Agora, they've got the amphitheater, they seem to have the same things.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm thinking that probably on the hillsides there were lots of
houses. On the hillsides there were some
but
houses.
But not up in the flat part that was built out.
Not up here.
Okay. But very close by.
Yes, and you can kind of see you can't really see, but there's some water over there on the other side of the hill. But today, if you were to go up there, rather than trudging up there, they have cable cars that take you up there. And so when you get off the cable car, it's over on this side kind of the hill, like over here. And as you're going up, like, you can see signs that say, like, here's a dwelling place, there's a dwelling place. So you still have to walk up a little bit to get to the top. But yeah, there are some houses there, just, yeah, not.
Well, these houses were just like side by side. I mean, rows and rows of them. And the ruins wasn't just the foundation. The walls were up about two feet or 3 feet high.
Yeah.
And I mean, you could walk in and you could see, well, this is a room, and this is a smaller room, and a hallway, and well, they would be like row homes, but they went on forever.
Yes, that is exactly right, because they're smart. Like, why would you build two walls if you just build one?
Right.
Makes sense. They're all adjoining, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I'm kind of curious, with that kind of magnificent structures, and some pillars still remaining, what happened? How did they all disappear over time? Was there a massive earthquake? Are they all buried under the ground?
Yes, that is one of the reasons. Yeah. So this area of the world has a lot of earthquakes. Actually, in fact, I felt a couple of tremors different times when I've been in Turkey. It is known to be earthquake prone. And when that happens, things fall over, and sometimes they get rebuilt. Sometimes they don't. Fires. Some of it is just disuse. It takes a long time for the land to actually cover it and swallow it back up, obviously. A lot of it, once it falls down, people would take it and reuse it in something else, spolia. So I lived in Scotland for 4 years, and we have beautiful cathedral, and it's fallen down. And people took a lot of the stones from that, and you can see it in the buildings, houses, the shops. Like, some of it came from the old cathedral, but they just took it and they reused it. So those are different ways that big buildings like this disappear over time. So yeah, it's a shame. But some of them you can still see. Yes, I was reading a little bit of that, and I don't want to tell you what's mislead you, but so it was built during the Attalid dynasty, so these two brothers, that story that I told you, and they had a big battle, Battle of the Galatians, and so they were building this to commemorate their victory. That's in part why they built it. And so some of the scenes show some of those battles. I think there are also some of the friezes that show the foundation myth of Pergamum as well. There's some other stuff up there. I've never gotten to see this myself. Maybe one day I'll go to Berlin and see it, but I believe that's what's on there. Probably some other stories. You had a question?
How long does it take them to build?
Yes. Yeah. I'm sure somebody knows. I don't. I don't know exactly. I would have to read up on that and find out.
Sure, is it 100 years and that person died and moved in, or just a man?
Yeah, I don't think it would take as long, because we know that they were actually worshiping, you know, during some of the emperor's lives in their temples, so it couldn't take that long. Know more about medieval architecture because I lived in a medieval town in Scotland, and so like that cathedral, this is in the Middle Ages, and so you don't have slaves and you don't have as much money, and other, that'd take 150 years to build that cathedral, and it did, but yeah, it wouldn't take as long because slaves, yeah.
Is most of that, I can see the places on the bottom where there are things that are missing, but is the colonnade original?
Okay, so how much is original and reconstructed? I would have to ask somebody. But yes, when you see something this nice, often a lot of it is reconstructed, and you can even see that.
You can see that on the base.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
But all those pillars?
Yeah, I mean, you can even see where it changes sometimes. Like from there, do you see the different coloration in those two? So oftentimes they'll do something like that to alert you to the fact that, hey, this was the original bit, and that's the part that we put in there, so you can have an idea of what it looked like. And sometimes they'll have a mixture of sites of rebuilding some things, reconstructing them, so that you see what it's like, but then leaving the others so you can kind of see what it looked like in situ, how, like, in its place, how how they found it. So.
So the Germans did tear all down and haul it early, and they probably picked it up off the ground and dug it out of the ground.
I don't know what it looked like when they started digging, but yeah, I don't think it looked like this. So, yeah.
Isn't the Turkish government asking for their altar back?
I don't know the state of that. I'll have a hard time getting it back.
It's back.
That that's a whole controversy because, a lot of the Western countries came to these countries and took a lot of the spoils when they were colonizing. What do you do with it now? Do you send it back? Do you keep it in the museums where they have it? Yeah, it's a whole big deal. Some things have been sent back, but especially if it was sold, and I think I would have to look this up, but under the Ottoman Empire, which is when they would have been doing the excavation, the Germans, the Sultan gave them permission, you know, and they would pay the Sultan something. So they kind of paid for some of this. It's not like they just ripped it off completely. So this was not a land that was actually colonized. If they took it, it's because the Sultan let them. That's different in some other parts of Africa and the Middle East and some other places. But yeah, they'd have a harder time getting it back, I think, because they bought and paid for it. Yeah.
Just a simple question. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just spelled differently in German. Different languages, yeah. Yeah. Any other questions? No? Gosh, you guys are so patient. I can't believe you stayed this long. So yeah, you're troopers for sure. Well, thank you. You can tell the pastor whether you want to have an additional week or if you want to do them all the last four next week. We can try to rush through them, so I'll let you tell him and he'll tell me. But, yeah. Thank
how
you so
do you
much.
All tell me? Now let me know.
You want a straw vote?
Straw vote now.
Yeah.